Last time, we went to some pretty great lengths to examine the culture and traditions common in Japan for the ceremonies used before and during weddings, and following death. Today, we're going to be putting this knowledge to use and look at the film which inspired this discussion in the first place, Shunji Iwai's A Bride for Rip Van Winkle. If you watched the previous half of this episode, then you already know what the film is about. And if you hadn't seen the film earlier, then hopefully you've taken the time to go and view A Bride for Rip Van Winkle. If you didn't watch the previous video, then pause this one and take the opportunity to go check that one out. Then, come back, and we're going to be jumping right into our analysis of A Bride for Rip Van Winkle. Be warned that there will be spoilers in this video. Everyone good? Good. Then let's begin.
We made specific note earlier of the two coexisting cuts of today's film. We believe that the very existence of more than one version of the film speaks to a metafictional commentary on the part of the film's creators. If one watches both versions of the film, one will notice numerous differences in the 3 and 4 hour versions, from minor conversational cuts to different camera angles to entirely removed or added scenes. The full version, in fact, is missing parts the director's cut possesses, and vice versa. In both versions, all core evidence for the main story is presented, but the viewer is given a different perspective on certain events and scenarios. This is framework and rhetoric at its finest. The two versions are so different that we would argue they have different themes entirely.
We believe that the 4-hour full version of A Bride for Rip Van Winkle is a character study and a meditation on the interactions between one's roles within society, their perceived reality, and mass media and technology. The 3-hour director's cut, meanwhile, is a condemnation of consumerism, celebrity, and the imagery associated with these two phenomena. We would like to first examine these differing themes, then examine how the two cuts of the film overlap. Given that they do share the same basic story, they naturally have several main themes in common.
First, the 4-hour cut of A Bride for Rip Van Winkle centers around an exploration of the differences between who we portray ourselves to be and who we actually are. When Mashiro explains that she is an actress who has simply not landed any major roles up to this point, we, along with Nanami, have no reason to disbelieve her. We perceive that reality entails her being an unsuccessful actor. Later, we learn that Mashiro is, in fact, an actress in adult films. She technically has not lied, but instead chosen to present herself through a half-truth, creating dissonance for both Nanami and the viewers with this discovery.
For a more general example of this, we can look at one of the main backgrounds against which the film's action occurs, that being the family rental service. Like in Noriko's dinner table, this service is used to examine how identity has shifted in the digital age. It's a time in which you can hypothetically be anyone you want to be behind the wall of anonymity provided by the internet. Where Shion Sono's 2005 film used bulletin board systems and forums, more the speed of online communication at that time, Iwai's vision uses the modern-day upgrade, the social media platform. Here, the metaphor brought up about Mashiro's status as an actress extends quite beautifully, given that she is quote-unquote acting online, rather than presenting the same self she does offline, where the characters living in Noriko's dinner table encounter issues when they come face-to-face with others, that is, once the internet is removed from the equation. In Rip Van Winkle, issues are allowed to arise much earlier, even in an online setting.
In a scene just before Nanami's marriage to her boyfriend, he discovers some of her posts on Planet, the fake social media platform on which the film's characters connect. He comments that, were Nanami to write things like this, he would have to divorce her. Of course, the dramatic irony of him complaining about her own words to her is clear, but her inner thoughts being posted here rather than on a forum present a new issue not seen 10 years ago. What Iwai is saying in this update to Sono's version is that the days are now gone when we could hide behind complete false identities. Given that the expectation nowadays is for social media accounts to be tied to our actual names and personalities. When Rip Van Winkle and Nanami meet, their first question is which platform the other uses. Is it Planet, an underdog created for the film, or Line, the actual largest platform by number of users in Japan?
Iwai seems to be saying that, due to the ubiquity of social media, anything that users say but try to hide will at some point emerge. Everything is now tied, no matter in how convoluted a manner, back to our true selves. Anonymity is a dying phenomenon on the internet. ultimately all of the information that we put there on social media is logged and recorded, unlike the sites of old which can fade into obscurity and be lost, like the fan boards we mentioned in our video on the Suicide Club fan community.
What's more, in terms of the film being similar but different from Noriko, our main cast in A Bride for Rip Van Winkle are all adults rather than teenagers. This is quite literally the more grown-up version of Sono's Noriko's dinner table. This presents us with some situations that would not have been possible in Noriko. In the exploration of different personas here, our main character moves through multiple jobs.
Meanwhile, Nanami's employer here, Amuro, is never entirely clear on his purpose or true role. He assumes at least three names in the film's runtime. Even in the three-hour cut, when he weeps alongside Mashiro's bereaved mother, we can't be sure whether he's sincere or just acting. The same goes for his telling the mortician, in a scene left out of the four-hour cut, about the money he made from Rip Van Winkle's death. All of the other characters crack at some point and show their humanity, not able to continue acting after a certain point, but it's never entirely clear what is acting and what isn't with Amuro. This makes him something of the perfect person to exist in this age of social media. He is someone who has adapted to have no true self, while all of the others can't quite mask themselves perfectly.
In fact, Mashiro's mother in the three-hour cut says, quote, "It's embarrassing to be naked in front of others," end quote. This statement is not to be taken literally, but metaphorically. Her alcoholism and fear of being exposed are traits of her personality, and speak to a disdain for being honest with herself and with others. On the same token, it's important that Mashiro is a porn star, because even when she bears it all, she is still putting on an act. This is not her true self. So, whether an alcoholic mother, or our two leads taking on different personas online and in their professions, the characters in Rip Van Winkle show us that through lies, we can expose our true selves comfortably.
One of the methods in which we perpetuate these lies is through our occupations. Nanami is embarrassed to try on a maid outfit in front of Amuro, but puts it on when she takes on the job as a maid. By the time she's living with Mashiro, she has finally found someone else with whom she can be comfortable. She's not using Planet anymore, not needing to pretend to be another person. At the very end of the four-hour cut, she returns to the teaching job from which she was let go at the beginning. Initially, she was relieved of her duties because she used a microphone to speak with her students, a petty prank from the class meant to comment on her soft-spoken nature. After her encounters with Mashiro, however, she doesn't need the mic to teach. Effectively, she has unified the parts of herself and become her true self, strengthening her resolve as an individual and her voice.
A Bride for Rip Van Winkle, specifically the three-hour cut, also asks us to question how reality is formed from these roles and the expectations that accompany them. In our interpretation of the film, we are being told that reality is created from people interfacing with one another. Thus, when we lie, we effectively change reality, just as when we reveal the truth. Personal perception paints the shared hallucination that is reality, meaning that if enough people believe something, it becomes as good as true. The problem, however, arises when someone refuses to take part in this shared hallucination, thus threatening everyone else's reality.
As we said previously, we view four ceremonies and one non-ceremony throughout the film: betrothal, wedding, memorial, funeral, and divorce. Just like symbols or words, none of these ceremonies or the traditions that surround them have any inherent value. Thus, through the shared hallucination of a national or cultural zeitgeist, their collectively perceived value becomes reality. As the film demonstrates through how it frames and portrays these ceremonies, it is possible to reach a point at which events like these become entirely hollow, notably when participants don't acknowledge the value they hold for others.
With the betrothal occurring so early in the film's runtime, we have nothing other than the character's actions to perceive its hollowness. On first viewing, things may seem decent, save Nanami's mother's drunken remarks about the young couple. With the first wedding, we see that Nanami's family is fabricated for the occasion. The image is more important than the reality, making the hollowness more obvious. With the second wedding, which Nanami attends as a fake family member, we learn that the polygamist groom is putting on the ceremony for show for his new bride, This means that not only are the attendees there for show, but in fact, the entire ceremony is a lie, intended to allow this new bride to partake in the delusion, the hallucination, that she is in fact getting married, despite the illegal nature of the event, given his previous marriage.
At the memorial, we see people merely going through the motions, making an appearance and displaying the melancholy expected of them. The image of the deceased is important here. Nanami's father-in-law is long gone at this point, but the memorial ceremony is held specifically to remember him as he was in life. At the funeral, Mashiro's false family from the second wedding comes to see her off. Her family's falseness presents a type of hollowness, but given that they directly interact with her casket and ashes, and the visceral reaction from her father, this is perhaps the least disingenuous ceremony present. The divorce, meanwhile, is extremely informal. Statistically, it might as well be a ceremony by now, but it's not held in a glamorous light, thus it is markedly unceremonious. In the 3-hour cut, the music played during the divorce sequence draws a corollary between Nanami's departure and all the other ceremonies, while in the 4-hour cut, it sets it apart, as no music is used during other ceremonies. With the exception of the funeral, which impacts the family as a whole, Nanami's divorce is the only quote-unquote ceremony which has an emotional impact on her alone, while all of the others fall flat.
All throughout these hollow ceremonies, an importance is placed on the image of the event rather than the actuality of it. At the funeral, we see the image selected to represent the deceased. At the wedding, attendees are hyper-focused on snapping pictures, which also ties into the film's focus on technology. All of them are expected to snap a literal fraction of a second of an hours-long ceremony, which will then serve to represent the event in its entirety. Thus, it allows those present to fabricate a perceived reality of the event. Mashiro subverts this expectation by taking pictures of what she actually cares about, herself and Nanami, rather than a bride and groom she doesn't know, further underscoring how fake the proceedings are.
During the second wedding in the 4-hour cut, we see the fake family meeting up and getting to know each other before the ceremony. We see how they grow close to one another in the short time they are allowed. Here, in the character study of the 4-hour version, we observe the behind-the-scenes aspects of it, while the 3-hour cut only shows the parts that would be seen publicly. In this way, the latter version displays the wedding, and in fact all of the ceremonies present, as the snapshots one might flip through in real life, or the video recorded by an attendee, rather than the raw, undoctored footage present in the 4-hour cut.
Along these same lines, at the funeral, in the 4-hour cut, we see the ugly parts of the ceremony. In a sequence wholly absent from the snapshots of the 3-hour version, the participants move Mashiro's bones and ashes into a container. They then exit the crematorium, and her false father gives a heart-wrenching speech. These portions express the humanity of these characters, as well as the depth of the bonds that these characters have formed. In the director's cut, we're not interested in the portions that one might forget or repress.
So that covers the main themes of the 4-hour full version of the film. It's a lengthy, heart-rending character study that exposes the hollowness of the moments in our lives we wish to maintain as idyllic, untouchable memories. The 3-hour director's cut has different aims, though it's not any more cheery.
In the 3-hour director's cut of A Bride for Rip Van Winkle, we find a deep-seated condemnation of celebrity, consumerism, and social media at large. Mashiro's character in particular is a condemnation of the idea that anyone can be famous, and perhaps of fame itself. She states, quote, "No one would notice if someone disappeared from the crowd," end quote. She's been acting for 10 years without a hit. She calls Planet a minor league platform compared to Twitter and Line, but still uses it. She can't seem to get into the major leagues in any field of life, but continues undeterred. This is likely due to the idea provided her by society that if she tries hard enough, she can one day attain the fame she deserves.
The condemnation of consumerism is also embodied boldly by Mashiro. Her taking roles in porn doesn't just signify her ability to act even when assumed to be naked. It exposes how those indoctrinated by consumerism will sell their literal flesh for the sake of garnering money. She has become rich doing something that her mother rails against, shown in her ability to afford the mansion. Her lifestyle is decadent, yet unhappy. Please note, none of this is us trying to condemn sex work in general. It's just that Mashiro is shown to be genuinely unhappy in what she's doing. Her mother has effectively disowned her due to her life choices. Mashiro means nothing to her, and she doesn't even want her ashes, nor to bury them. However, she will take the money that's left behind.
Earlier in the film, Mashiro says that money buys her happiness. There's too much happiness in the world, she says, and money limits how much joy anyone can have, so that its sheer enormity won't crush them. The mother echoes this with her excessive alcohol consumption, merely replacing cold hard cash with a literal drug rather than a metaphorical one. She buys happiness and will likely do the same with her daughter's leftover money. The film seems to claim that money is apolitical. It's such raw power that no one cares where it comes from, only what it can do for them.
Before she dies, Mashiro spends a good bit of her wealth on poisonous animals. At one point, she seems ready to touch a blue-ringed octopus, saying that the poisonous nature of the creature only makes her want to touch it more. Toward the end of the 3-hour cut, she comments on wanting to die. She doesn't explicitly say it, but her money hasn't truly been able to buy her happiness. Nanami cries at hearing her profess this want, and Mashiro says that Nanami's tears finally make her feel something. As she puts it, quote, "I could give anything for those tears. I could even give my life," end quote. She can die happy, knowing that someone can separate the true her from her roles and her money, that Nanami can love her for her true self. Through this interaction, we see that Iwai is telling us that money and the false happiness it can buy is no replacement for genuine human relationships.
In terms of the 3-hour cut's third condemnation, all of this is allowed to happen, or is at least expedited, by social media. The concept of being famous on, or thanks to, the internet is propagated by the idea that social media more or less levels the playing field between everyday citizens and celebrities. While we never directly explore this celebrity aspect within the film, Mashiro's act of calling herself an actress and the importance of social media in helping her meet Nanami helps us draw the correlation. Paradoxically, the voice amplification allowed by social media makes celebrity both more powerful, since we all had the illusion we can become one, but also more worthless, since, again, everyone can achieve it. Due to her illusions of grandeur and her terrible downfall, Mashiro is, in a way, an example of this.
Now that we've examined the differences between the two cuts of the film, let's examine the shared attributes of the story as a whole.
Firstly, A Bride for Rip Van Winkle presents us with a markedly improved version of character building for Shunji Iwai compared to his already strong theatrical debut, Love Letter. In our episode on that film, we spoke at length on how effectively Iwai built the character out of our lead's deceased husband, a character who only appears in flashback, but who is an intensely fleshed out character nonetheless. In Rip Van Winkle, we see this knack for character creation extended in terms of both imagery and writing.
In Nanami's relationship with her boyfriend/husband, Tetsuya, we never hear either of them say, "I love you," nor do we observe them kissing. This allows us to draw our own conclusions on how much affection they hold for one another. After getting divorced, once Tetsuya is out of the picture, Nanami moves into a hotel. Here we observe the colors changing, becoming more muted and tumultuous compared to the clean whites of the film's first hour or two. In the 3-hour cut of the film, we are given some extra character reactions to various events. Specifically, we observe during the betrothal ceremony that Nanami's father is unsure of the union, and her mother is more obviously drunk compared to the 4-hour cut. Lastly, the restaurant where Nanami meets Amuro after her wedding is empty. This tells us that they are meeting during work hours, meaning that she hasn't taken a new job since losing her teaching position, and that he works a strange job. Neither of them are working class citizens, in other words.
Through all these subtle pieces of imagery, we learn quite a bit about the film's cast of characters and how they present themselves and what they do or don't say. Mostly, we learn about Nanami this way, but through others' reactions to her, we learn how she interfaces with the world. Speaking of Nanami,
In my personal opinion, this stands in direct contrast with the grievance brought by some film critics that Nanami is too much of a blank slate, and that she is simply too boring of a character to carry an entire film, much less one of this length. In fact, I believe that much of her characterization is buried beneath the surface, which speaks to her being somewhat repressed, at least in the first few acts of the film. She struggles in silence outwardly, using her account on Planet to vent her true feelings, which provide the film's only narration. The critics are correct in calling Nanami a blank slate, but only because she won't explore her own depth in the first half of the film. She creates multiple personae to protect herself, in fact creating a new account on Planet once her first one is discovered by her fiancé. She needs her personal space, but is uncomfortable acting for herself and presenting her true self until the very end. At the story's conclusion, she's being the most honest about who she is. We don't need to see her come into her own, as this is at the conclusion of the narrative. The point of her arc in both versions is for her to break from these created selves, and to unify the parts which truly represent Nanami's motivations and desires. Thus, Nanami may appear to be a boring character on the surface, but she is truly much deeper than anyone has given her credit for.
In a similar way, EY has learned by this point how to effectively take expectations based on the initial interactions and appearances of characters, then wholly flip them on their head via strong writing. Mashiro is probably the best argument for this. When Nanami first encounters her and is down on her luck and depressed, Mashiro acts like a manic pixie dream girl. For viewers who hate this trope, they may be initially turned off by her actions, but as Nanami grows closer to Mashiro, we learn that she has a lot more going for her in terms of character depth.
Earlier in the film, after the betrothal ceremony, Nanami's father talks with Nanami about remaining with her mother until the wedding, for appearances. With barely any lines or screen time in the film, Ewai provides us with enough to understand the strained nature of her parents' relationship, without anyone delivering exposition in a heavy-handed manner. Next, we have the entire paradox of Amuro's character. He's intentionally written to be as obscure and confusing as possible. In the runtime of the film, we never learn his true name, nor his true feelings about literally any of the situations in which we observe him. He, in a way, is something like the filmmaker in a metaphorical sense, using words and images to manipulate his audience in numerous ways, while removing himself from the art he is producing whenever he pleases. Along with all of these other examples, EY has clearly learned much about subtle character building in the two decades since Love Letter.
So that's A Bride for Rip Van Winkle, the long, subtle, maybe too subtle, diverse, dare we say, masterpiece from Shinji Iwai. This is the type of film that doesn't deserve your attention based solely on its length, but on the merit buried within its 3-4, collectively 7-hour runtime. Be sure to check this one out if you get the chance, and here's to hoping that it's not another decade until Shinji Iwai's next fiction film.